Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
We just thank you for all our many blessings and we look forward to Thanksgiving this weekend. There's so many people that probably won't have food, but I have food. Anyway, we just thank you, Lord, for everything that you do for us and all our blessings. And these things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Linda. Mm-hmm. We've got a special treat tonight, along with our number of guests from the Scouts. Again, I'm not sure how many different troops are represented here. Craig, do we have a count?
I think about five.
Five different troops. And they have asked, and we are honored to have them lead us in the pledge, and they will be doing that by getting their groups together and bringing in the colors. So at this time, if we could all stand, and we'll turn it over to the Scouts.
Color guard, advance. Join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Color guard, post the colors. Color guard, dismiss. You may be seated.
Thank you very much. It's certainly good to see everyone here tonight, and again, the Scouts that are present with us. I think it's so important to have you attend a public meeting, see a little bit about government in action. I would also like to invite the members of the Leadership Alamance Group. We have four of representatives here tonight. A couple weeks ago was your Government Day, if I understand. That's right, the full day was government, and part of your homework assignment was to attend one of the public meetings in the area. So you got the short straw and you're here with us tonight. Welcome to you. At this time, we will invite the public comments. Before the start of each minute, we have a period of time when individuals can come and speak to the board about anything that's on their mind. We limit these comments to 3 minutes, but anybody can talk about whatever matter they would like to bring before us. And we have two tonight. We'll start with Margaret Dameron. Margaret, welcome to you. Please come forward. You're doing fine.
And first of all, I'm glad to see everybody back. Hope we have another 4 good years. But anyway, this is my first thing. I hope that all of you stand behind him. Not behind him, but beside him. Because he's the best sheriff we've ever had. And I think we deserve this money, and I think we should get it. If you need help, call me.
You heard that, didn't you, Terry?
Yes, sir. I'm a dollar number.
That's right.
The second thing is, I think we should help keep the State Farm, prison farm, where they raise the vegetables and things. I think we should get in behind them and help keep it. They should never, ever break that up. Because there's a lot of young kids that go up there that probably would have been sent to a state prison in Raleigh. And if I sound nervous, I am. Not usually. But unless you've been raised in an orphanage, you wouldn't understand it. And I was. in Danville, Virginia. And anything the government gets into, it flies all to pieces. I had to change my language just a little. Because I don't know, they destroyed that orphanage, sold it out. Same way they did with Elon. And look how many lives it hurt. And I can tell you it was quite a few. So I think we should stand in behind them and keep it. See if we can maybe not force them, but help them to keep it.
Are you talking about the one in Gibson then?
The Guilford County Prison Farm.
Yeah.
We go up and buy stuff every year. So that's what I had to say.
Thank you, Margaret.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Now I'd like to call on John Oakes. John, welcome to you.
Commissioners, good evening. John Oakes, Burlington.
Good evening.
Good to see everybody. In September of 2010, for the first time I spoke before you to express my support and ask for your support for our Sheriff Terry Johnson, whom I had never met or spoken with. I made that decision after months of listening to accusations of discrimination by the same few people biweekly, month after month, and also reading about claims of discrimination by the Department of Justice. What was frustrating for me personally was that many of the folks that kept coming before you appeared to me to be sincere and compassionate. But as I continued to listen, observe, and read their accusations of discrimination against the sheriff, I asked myself, why hasn't anyone specifically said what the sheriff has done and how he's discriminating? I personally came to the conclusion that the accusations of discrimination were and are politically motivated. I will stand by that assertion until facts are presented that prove otherwise. And I respectfully ask each of you with your positions of power, influence, and as our elected leaders to do the same. Excuse me. I'm anxious tonight too. I respectfully ask you to publicly support Sheriff Johnson, not only with words, but with a commitment to financial support if required. To state support for Sheriff Johnson in words alone is null and void of any true support, in my opinion. Make it crystal clear to everyone that you intend to support Sheriff Johnson, not with words only, but with monetary resources that may be required to validate your stated support. I have since spoken to Sheriff Johnson on the telephone a few times over the last couple of years to encourage him, let him know that I appreciate his service as well as his deputies and all they do to protect this county. Who amongst us would want to concede to something we did not do? Who amongst us would want to get up every day for years with this type of stress, not to mention the day-to-day stress of operating a sheriff's department? It's no wonder good and decent people are getting harder and harder to fill positions of public trust. Excuse me, I'm trying to get it in that 3 minutes. I'll close with this. Between 970 and 930 BC, a king by the name of Solomon and other unidentified men wrote this. If a ruler listens to lies, all his officials become wicked. If a king judges the poor with fairness, his throne will always be secure. Do not testify against your neighbor without cause or use your lips to deceive. The accomplice of a thief is his own enemy. He is put under oath and dare not testify. Respectfully ask each of you to privately and publicly, with your words and resources that the citizens of Alamance County have entrusted you with, to support Sheriff Johnson. I am confident that the vast majority of good and decent people of all races and ethnicity will support you for doing so. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Are there any responses from the commissioners at this time? If not, we'll move to the next item on the agenda, which is the approval of the agenda. Commissioners, if you will review the agenda and also the consent agenda, which includes items mostly appointments that we have to various boards that the county's involved in, as well as some standard leases that come up for renewal. It's items that typically don't warrant a lot of discussion, but our commissioners, any commissioner, can pull an item off the consent agenda for discussion. Craig, do you have any changes to the agenda tonight?
Yes, sir. We do have one change, and we can do this under my update, is the bond resolution declaration. This is required by statute. After the election and the canvassing, the board must declare the results of the bond vote, and then we have to advertise it in the paper. So the canvassing, I think, was finished on Thursday afternoon late.
So we want to add that to item number 10, your report?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And you should have a copy of it in front of
you. That was distributed separate?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Commissioners, any other changes to the agenda or any item on consent that you wish to be pulled?
I don't want to pull anything, but unless I'm overlooking something here, we used to do our agenda to where, for instance, on a consent agenda, if you had an item like consent agenda is 5 overall, and then you've got A, B, C, D, E, you would have it on each sheet as 5A1, 5A2, and so forth. Can we do that? I mean, we're not doing it right now, are we?
Yeah. It would be easy to pick it up.
It'd be easier to track it as far as rolling down to it. And even when it was not on iPads, it was still hard for me to get to each item succinctly as I would like to. So.
So it's a matter of formatting it differently?
That's the way we used to do it.
Okay. But you're okay with the presentation tonight?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other items that you'd like to have reviewed or discussed, pulled? If not, we'll take a entertain a motion for approval of the agenda, which will include the consent agenda.
So moved.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Tim. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good. Thank you. Item 6 is budget amendments number 42 and 43 to the Health Department. Welcome, Barry Bass. Welcome, sir.
Commissioners, thank you for this opportunity to speak to you this evening. We have two different amendments before you tonight. The first one involves an asthma grant that we've been getting for the past 3 years, and actually this is a fourth year, so we didn't anticipate this money coming in, but we're glad that it does. You may recall that we use these funds at the schools, working with community education, putting the flags and some of the magnetic stickers that shows the different colors of the air code, and working with the schools in terms of community education and such. So we'd like to ask if you all would be amenable to allow us to continue this with the funding of the $9,904 for fiscal year 2012-13.
Any questions for Barry about that? That's number 42?
Yes, sir.
There are no questions. Entertain a motion for approval.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you.
Number 43.
Yes, sir. And the next item is some additional funding that we got for some work that was done by environmental health staff. It involved over the summer that they were doing a food service program. And as you can see, they were reimbursed an amount of $82.82, and they did 39 inspections. So we were allocated $2,230 for those efforts, and we will be using those funds for training, for buying GIS ARC for our computers. And we're using a lot of information, trying to track where we're doing, like where food services are in the graves and such, to keep up with our inspections. So that's where those monies will be going towards. I'd ask your consideration to approve it.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
Item number 7, the Sheriff's Annual Report. I'd like to welcome Sheriff Terry Johnson.
Good evening, sir. Good evening. First of all, I'd just like to thank Ms. Dameron for her kind remarks, and also John Oakes for his support. This tonight will be our 2011, show you what the Alamance County Sheriff's Department did in the year 2011, finances, overall operations, et cetera, our annual report to the commissioners. And the reason it's been so late in the year is y'all had so many other things going on. Some meetings were moved and some were full. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
Can we center that somehow?
That's got to be moved over somehow.
Where's Scott?
I don't know. Well, that's live.
The old-fashioned way.
Yeah.
There you go.
It's a good thing to have a scout leader around.
Scott, can we turn one of the lights off?
It's on the screen. While he's working on that, I'd like to welcome the Boy Scouts here also. Let me tell you, it's good to have y'all at one of our meetings.
Yeah, turn the first one back on. Is that all right with everybody? Yeah, that looks good.
That looks good. Yeah.
Now we got to move back the other way.
Anyway, I'll bypass the message in the sheriff's office mission statement. It's still off. That probably needs to go back a little bit. There you go. You're a good man. Where's the red area? If you'll notice, this is the fiscal year 2011 and 2012 at the top, our past year, which was 2010 and 2011. The sheriff's office budget that was given to us was $9,882,599. SRO budget, which part of that is financed through the school system for our school resource officers. Our jail budget that was given to us was $8,671,895.55 for a total of $18,933,700.53. Now, these are the revenues that come in, and I will say the 2011 year, we were off on revenues because of the ICE situation in the jail. The numbers got down because of policy changes in Washington, D.C. So a lot of our revenue in the jail was down. The year before, you notice we had $4,667,429.08 in revenue. And then this past year, only a little over $2 million. We actually spent and appropriated to us was what you see here for the sheriff's budget, the SRO budget, the jail budget, a total of $17,635,458.94. After taking all the revenue that was brought in through the sheriff's office as far as permits, etc., was 970 some thousand plus. SRO, this is the money the school system give us reimbursed. This is what we made off of the detention center for a total of $3,713,341.42. If you take the revenue coming in from the appropriation, we actually used from the general fund only $13,922,117.52. We also, at the end of 2012, we turned back into the county. I don't know if you remember that. Turned back into the county. Look at that. $1,298,241.59. Okay. Net cost to local taxpayers, this is the money from the general fund, was actually $13,922,117.52 that we actually used on from the fund that was given to us by the county. The rest, like I say, was offset by the revenues that we received. And a little bit of information to you right now, it's looking good as far as revenue coming from the jail because the marshal has brought in more prisoners. They're looking after me. And because of our misdemeanors that we're holding, it's really been generating some funds that I hope will help us. But you can see the difference in the 2010-2011 year and the 2011-2012, most of it because of the loss of revenue from ICE. Okay. This is what the state does. It tells, and I'm telling you, this is how we stack up in the county as far as sworn personnel per 1,000. Alamance County Sheriff's Office right now, I think, 2.1 But up there, when we did this, was 2.2 officers per 1,000 population. If you'll notice, every department in the county was equal to or much bigger than us. However, our records, as you'll see in a little bit, speaks for itself. We've got hardworking people that's out there shaking the bushes. Mebane PD was the only one that had less officers per 1,000 population. But the national average, like I say, I think it's 2.4 per 1,000 now. Okay, this is staggering, and I'll be honest with you. Calls for service, 38,465 calls for service this year, 2011-2012. Over 5,332 investigations. And gentlemen, these investigations are homicide investigations, murder, rape. You just don't do them overnight, believe me. It's very time consuming. We did security checks at over 2,918 businesses or homes. If a person goes on vacation, they call in, they give us his address, and CCOM, a tone goes off, we know we got to do that, check that house or that business. Security check while they're out there. There's over 1,260 citations written, 2,693 arrests, 4,394 warrants received, 3,275 warrants served. Civil papers is staggering. It's killing us in a lot of ways because of the economy. People, you know, are getting sued, losing homes and stuff, and we have to serve those papers. So, 12,724 papers were received. We served 9,897. Some of them were recalled because people called up on their civil papers returned, 2,389. Gun permits issued, 2,605. Issued carrying concealed weapon permits issued, 764. It's amazing the number of people that are carrying concealed weapons right now that I'm afraid eventually, if things go bad in Washington and there's a scene, something happens and the country goes wild, you're going to have a lot of people toting guns. Property stolen, $1,399,832. We recovered $234,966 worth. Animal control. Calls for service, 2,208. And I'll tell you what, I get more heat over an animal than I do a double homicide. That's unbelievable. 995 investigations, and we transported 2,064 animals to the shelter. Moving on. Crime rates. I'm very proud of the Alamance County Sheriff's Department on our crime rate stuff. As you can see, in 2010, we had 5 murders. We cleared 4. And then in 2011, we had 1 murder and cleared that murder. And we know on most of all our murders that are unsolved, and not but a few, we know who done it. It's just a matter of getting the case, putting the case together. Rapes. In 2010, we had 5 cleared, 5. We had 2011, we had 3 cleared, 2. Robbery. In 2010, we had 12 cleared, 7. 2011, we had 4 cleared, 2. Aggravated assault, as you can see, 92 and 69, 86 and 70. And then there's your totals at the bottom. Then you go to burglaries. And this is something that's really, because of the number of people we have on the street and the number of calls, is taking our people away from doing their patrolling and catching people going in houses. And of course, we respond once the call comes in. But it's a whole lot harder to cover the 428 square miles of Alamance County patrolling, and when you're having to answer the number of calls that we're answering. So that's where you can see the larceny, 581. We cleared 151. 2011, we had 594, cleared 139. Motor vehicle thefts, and then, of course, your property totals and your overall totals. And as you can see, that's a lot of work that has to be done. This is what I'm proud of. This is not my statistics. This is the state of North Carolina SBI statistics. Out of the top 25 law enforcement agencies with similar population to Alamance County, we have the 3rd best index crime rate as far as clearance, etc. And I'm very proud of that. And believe me, we report every crime that comes into the Alamance County Sheriff's Office. You can look there, you can see what I'm talking about. In 2011, we ranked 45th in the state in all clearance against all agencies, which they were 388. 2010, we were 61st. So we are improving. That costs the same, you know, we've got the same manpower, so people are hustling out there trying to get the job done. Clearance rate. Violent crimes, you got the United States clearance rate for murder 64.8. You got North Carolina, which is 86.2. Alamance County for 2011, you got 100% clearance rate on Alamance County. Rate, United States, the clearance rate is 40.3%. North Carolina's 59.1%. We have a 67% clearance rate. Robbery, United States is 28.2. North Carolina's 40.9. We had 50%. Aggravated assault, 56.4 United States clearance rate. North Carolina 67.8. We had an 81% clearance rate. Then you go to your property crimes. Burglary, the United States is 12.4. North Carolina's 18.3. We have a 20%. That's not good enough. We're going to get better. Larceny, United States 21.1. North Carolina 28.9. And we were below the North Carolina average, but above the national average on the larceny. Motor vehicle, 11.8% clearance in the United States. North Carolina, 23.6. And in our sheriff's office was 44% clearance rate. And that, as you can see here, we just did a graph so you could visually see the situation. And as far as the sheriff's office, as far as clearance comparison, and I won't go into that because I basically just went over that for you. Okay, detention. From July 2006 to December 2011, the detention center generated, please listen, $25,883,080.66 in revenue holding immigration and custom enforcement inmates and U.S. Marshal inmates some local. Revenue is primarily generated through the leasing of unused bed space to federal authorities. However, this figure does not include local, state, inmate reimbursement, transportation fees, court to jail fees, Social Security reimbursement, SCAP, inmate medical charges, or commissary phone commissions. Transporting activity. We had 1,053 transport events. Inmates transported, 1,810. And folks, that's all over the state of North Carolina. I'm talking about all the way to Dare County, back and forth. Medical transports. We carried 318 inmates to the hospital for some reason when they were booked into the center. 121,157 miles driven. Inmate admission activity. We admitted 5,279 federal inmates in our detention center. 5,680 were pre-trial. 854 were sentenced and in our facility. We brought back for trial 248, and when this report was done, we only had one state misdemeanant in our jail for a total of 12,062 inmate admission activity. And our detention center, I'm telling you, stays busy. I think today we had 450-some, I think, in the detention facility. Our maximum capacity is 476 as far as bed space, but that's not always true. Drug asset forfeiture. In 2011, the Sheriff's Office in cooperation with local, state, and federal authorities seized $4,343,857 in currency, vehicles, and property pursuant to a drug investigation. Over $291,066.37 was awarded to the Sheriff's Office by virtue of asset forfeiture laws. These monies are used to purchase equipment to offset costs to the taxpayer, and we have purchased cars, we've purchased all our weapons and stuff with federal drug seize money, and I go on and on and on. That's the only way we've been able really to survive, and we don't have a problem with that simply because the economy is bad here. And that's just some of the drugs and monies that we've seized. Over 500 validated gang members presently in Alamance County. And the saying is, for every one validated gang member, there are 10 associates. So you're probably looking at 5,000 active gang members really in Alamance County, Burlington, Graham, and the areas. The age of typical gang members between 9 and 32. Juveniles represent about 58% of the gang population and 91% are male. Let me tell you what's happening now. All your drug smugglers.
from Mexico are coming in trying to recruit our young people, well-dressed young people, because they don't stick out like a drug dealer, and have them transport dope and hold dope for them. And that's where a lot of these gangs are starting to really surface. Durham is trying to recruit in the Alamance County gang members. Greensboro, we're right in between two highly infested gang areas, and they're trying to recruit here. So we've got to do whatever we can to stop our young people. And scouts, you listen to me. That's why you need to stay in scouting. That's why you need to learn responsibility, and that's why you need to learn discipline. Gangs come in all genders. This was taken at a high school or a school here in Alamance County. This was taken at a local middle school here in Alamance County, and this is just one of those wonderful people who come in there, Jim, got his picture to it. Domestic violence, thanks to you commissioners and the development of the Family Justice Center here, we have made a great impact on domestic violence here in the county. When I first became sheriff, and up to now, approximately 50% of the homicides we had here in Alamance County were domestic violence related. Luckily, I think this last year we only have one domestic violence. But as you can see, across state domestic violence displaced 14,347 persons that stayed in domestic violence shelters. 6,370 were children, and I could read on and on and on. But your 74 persons were victims of domestic related homicides in the state of North Carolina. School resource officers. You guys better listen to this, but you got school resource officers in your schools. For the 2010-2011 year, we had 1,379 occurrences on school property. It come down a little bit in 2011-2012 by about 8, but there was 16 felony arrests in 2010-2011 on the school grounds, and in 2011-2012 there was 15 felony drug arrests. There were 10 the year 2010-11. They were 3 school year 2011-2012, which is good. Misdemeanor arrests in 10-11 was 166, in 11-12 was 240. Misdemeanor drug arrests in 10-11 was 71, and it's down in the school year 2011-2012. Weapons confiscated, 12 in the year 2010-2011, and 16 in 2011-2012. I'm talking about guns and knives on campus. And we have recovered and taken several guns. Our SROs work extremely hard with the school system. And I will say this, Dr. Cox has made a big difference in our working relationship with the school system. DARE, we still do DARE in all the elementary schools in the county. Clover Garden, Pleasant Grove, V. Everett Jordan, Alexander Wilson, M. Holton Sylvan Elementary School. And as long as I'm sure, we're going to continue to do that program. And it said the Alamance County Sheriff's Office DARE program reached 610 students during the school year in these local schools. And that's just the 2011-2012 year. Internet crimes against kids. Let me tell you something. There's some sick people in this world, Mr. Lashley. They get on their computers and try to recruit young teenagers and young kids for sexual purposes. And we made numerous arrests. And I'll be honest with you, I'm getting very upset with some of our court system and judges. If you read today's paper, you'd see that we had 2 or 3 in there with numerous violations. They put them on probation, and guess what? We'll catch them again. They'll just be harder to catch. Child pornography. And that's basically it. Do you have any questions?
Questions, comments for the sheriff?
Very good.
Thank you, Ms. Manson.
Very good presentation.
Thank you, Ms. Manson. Thank you, Mr. Bob. And we're going to miss you.
I do have...
Yes, sir.
The article in the paper about the coyotes, is that something you guys have seen?
Listen, I live out in the country. I'm a country boy. We've got coyotes like you wouldn't believe out there. They're killing our animals. They're killing the deer. And the county's getting overrun by coyote. You go over toward Castle County, whoa, it's unbelievable.
The deer population is almost half of what it used to be because of coyotes.
I was really surprised to see that.
It's unbelievable.
And believe it or not, I heard there's some wild pigs now coming into Alamance County.
Where are they from?
You draw the question. I have no idea, but if I talk to one, I'll let you know.
They're coming out of Orange County.
Yeah, coming out of Orange County.
You didn't check their passport when they came in.
No, sir. I love to.
That is, I'm very serious, that's an excellent report. And I think a lot of folks don't understand the breadth of what you guys cover and the number of different things that you touch and have to touch and respond to. And you and your entire department are certainly to be commended for helping. And in a always changing county, I mean, everything is moving.
Well, I really appreciate that. We do have some wonderful people down there. Mr. Manning worked extremely hard. And I really appreciate, like I say, y'all's support. I will tell you this, I'm a big boy, and I can handle whatever heat comes with it. So we're going to do our job.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very
much.
Okay, can we restore the lights? And
yeah. Yeah, thank you.
This time we will move to item number 8 and call Sherry Hooks to talk about the health insurance renewals. Always an exciting topic.
Sorry about that. Good evening, commissioners. I have 3 topics for discussion and approval tonight, or possible approval. And I'm just going to kind of go through the overview and be happy to answer any questions that you have. The first one is a proposal to renew our health insurance for our retirees who are Medicare eligible. As you know, back in 2008, we moved this group to a separate insurance policy that coordinates with Medicare. And in doing so, we pretty much moved them to a fully funded plan. The rates for last year were $292 per person per month. Those rates this year have been reduced to $259 per person per month, and that is without any changes in benefits. So we're excited about that, and that is a savings of about $93,000 a year for the county. So that is our first recommendation, is to continue with that insurance program. The second recommendation from the Health Insurance Committee has to do with Piedmont Health Coalition. We've talked about this several times in the past, whether to be a member of the coalition, whether not to be a member of the coalition. Our concern with being a member has always been that we have not used the coalition in the way that other members have used it. The coalition is a group of companies here in Alamance County. There are about 12 of them that have come together to get basically better buying power from the local hospital. In doing so, those other companies have forced their employees to get their services strictly from ARMC or to request a waiver to go to another hospital, Duke, UNC, or Cone. And we've always been uncomfortable in doing that because we just don't feel like we're the ones that are qualified to say, yes, we'll give you a waiver, no, we won't give you a waiver. And it's actually the company's HR representative who's making that decision. So we have talked back and forth with the coalition about, is there a way that we can create a steerage program so that we're able to take advantage of the discounts that the other members are getting without forcing our employees to go to ARMC. So they have finally, after months and months, come up with an agreement to where we will do education programs and encouragement, but not steerage to ARMC. We're going to allow ARMC to come in, talk more about their new programs, talk about how their relationship with Cone may change things, allow them to have new opportunities that our employees may take advantage of. So they have put together a scenario that would say, if we are able to get 92% of our hospital admissions into ARMC, they will let us take advantage of their tier one pricing. For us, what that means is that in the first year, we're going to get to take advantage of the tier one pricing. The potential savings to that is between $135,000 and $232,000. if we do not get up to their mark of what they want the utilization to be, then the then we would have to refund $50,000 to them. So the 232 is if we can meet that benchmark. The 135 is if we're not able to meet that benchmark. But the insurance committee recommends that we stay with the coalition at least for a year to see how it works out and take advantage of that tier one pricing for the next year. So that's number two. Number three is through our discussions with Piedmont Health Coalition, and we have been introduced to a new way to do our pharmacy benefit management. Right now we've done this with WellPath, and they are the ones that have the company that you use, and they basically administer anything, everything, and we really don't have a lot of contact with that pharmacy benefit manager. The concern that we have, or what we've learned in talking with other companies that do it a little bit differently, is that there are pharmacy companies you can work with that have more transparent models. They share their discounts with you more clearly. And the pharmacy rebates that are available out there, a lot of times those get hidden from the end user, which would be Alamance County, and there's no way for us to see what pharmacy rebates are being given to the pharmacy benefit manager. By using a different company, which is ProCare RX, we'll be able to more clearly see what those rebates are and make sure that Alamance County's getting those rebates, not the pharmacy benefit manager. The proposal, they have looked at our claims over the past couple of years. They have looked at other members' claims. Piedmont Health Coalition has been using them since July, and they are recognizing some savings. The proposal that they have given to us has potential savings of $254,000 to $319,000. There is one decision. For the most part, employees will not be affected by this change other than they'll get a new insurance card. But there is one thing that we can enact, and that is we can make the decision to eliminate Walgreens as a pharmacy. And in doing that, the savings is about $65,000. What it does is it gives the pharmacy benefit manager more power in negotiating with the other large pharmacies in our contract. So there is a lot of potential savings there. Again, we have worked with ProCare. Their normal contract is a two-year contract. We have talked them into a one-year contract just so that we can see, is this something that'll work for us? Is this something that doesn't work for us? So the commitment that we would be faced with PBH, or I mean, I'm sorry, Piedmont Health Coalition and ProCare would be a one-year commitment. And if you look at the savings, combining those with the Advantra savings, you're looking at potential savings of a minimum $359,000 to $521,000. So at this time, I've given you also on that sheet sort of an overview of what our medical and prescription costs have looked like over the last 5 years, and as you can see, we've been very fortunate in that we've been able to control our cost, and some of that control has been through programs that we've put in place with our wellness, the clinic that we've opened, and we just feel like if we just need to keep looking at new ways to control those costs, and the insurance committee feels that moving in this direction will be other ways to help control these costs. So with that said, our recommendation would be to move to the Advantra, keep our membership with Piedmont Health Coalition at least for a year, and then move our pharmacy over to ProCare RX for a year and try that out. So I've tried to make it brief. I know it's not fun. So are there any questions, concerns about these things?
Was Medco ever looked at for that?
Medco is who our current pharmacy manager is, and that's just a standard contract that WellPath has with them. It has worked well for us, but like I said, there's not a lot of information sharing, and there's no way for us to clearly see, are we getting to take advantage of all the rebates, or are there some that get held back from us?
And I see where they're merging with somebody else.
there are a lot of those pharmacy benefit managers that are merging.
I forgot the name of it, but, because I order a lot from Nico and for myself. But they are merging with another company, or the other company's taking them over, I think.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, first I want to thank Sherry for the work that she's done on this, and also Commissioner Sutton on the Insurance Committee. It is one of those things that we're trying something new, but the positive thing about it is what we're trying is not going to cost us any money. It possibly could save us a lot of money, and what we would be asking for is if we could do this for a year, then we can gauge and see how much money we really are saving, and if it's worth the effort in staying with the coalition and staying with this new drug company, and then we'll be able to report back to you about potential savings. But the positive thing about this, there is no cost associated with it, only savings.
When do you plan to have this to go in effect?
It would be effective January 1st.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You need a motion?
I do.
I'll move that we go to that.
I'll give you a second on that, Bill.
Thank you, Bill and Eddie. Is there other discussion? I want to echo Craig's comments. I know in looking at insurance matters like this, it is detailed, and it can get very detailed. So, I applaud everybody that's on your committee. I do just have a couple of questions. What reason did the Advantra Group give you for their decline? Does it have to do with the people we have, the retirees that are currently on, compared to who was on a year ago?
It has to do with how our retirees, their claims over the past year, and then it also has to do with some of the changes with health care reform and the reimbursement rates for Medicare. So it's kind of a combination of both.
Are their benefits changing?
Their benefits are not changing, no.
And with the county employees that are on the plan, they currently have a WellPath card, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And they currently have like a separate dental card.
They do.
Okay. Now, will they have a third card for pharmacy?
No. What'll happen is that if on the WellPath card that they have right now, at the bottom of it, it has the Medco information. So WellPath is going to reprint cards for us and put the ProCare information on it. Even though the two businesses are not connected, WellPath is going to print new cards for us.
Okay.
And ProCare has already had discussions with WellPath about how the cards should look and given them their BIN numbers and all the information that they need. So the employee will just throw away their old card, have a new one, and when they go to the pharmacy the first time, they'll present their new one.
So as far as the employee, we're just changing like we have in the past, but they're still...
Yeah, on the employee's end, they're really not going to see much difference. They'll get a new card. They won't be able to go to Walgreens, but we've looked at utilization, and utilization at Walgreens is about 8% or less, so we don't feel it'll have a big impact on employees. The other piece that ProCare tries to do is encourage employees to use the mail order program. So employees that are on maintenance drugs, instead of you going to the pharmacy every 30 days, ProCare is going to send you information about how to order those drugs through the mail, and that is a way that they save money as well, too. Medco has a mail order pharmacy program, but it really does not save the employee much money. It really has not been a benefit for the plan to encourage employees to do this. With ProCare, there are savings there. And I guess it's just from volumes. So they are going to encourage employees to do their maintenance drugs through mail order.
And
it's not going to be required, but
they'll show the cost direct versus the cost of going through the mail.
Employees would see the difference because, as you remember, employees on prescriptions pay a percentage of the cost. So they will see that there is a difference with the mail order, and that's part of ProCare, is being able to give them the cost of what it would be if they ordered it through the mail.
So they'll provide that material?
Yeah, they'll provide all of that.
And as far as the employees that have their family cover, are they going to see a premium change this year?
For family coverage, no. The premiums, remember, we're fully funded, so your premiums were determined in the budget year.
Okay, so that stays until mm-hmm. June 30th.
Yeah, the premiums are on fiscal year, but the plan itself runs a calendar year.
We do have a motion and a second. Any other questions or discussion? All in favor of adopting these three changes that were introduced by Sherry, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
Tim, thank you for your contributions on that committee.
It's hard to imagine that there's anybody that could provide more information than Ms. Hook.
You did a good job.
Yes, yes. And your letter summarized things pretty well also.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Sherry. Next item is something that Craig and Clyde and Gerald have been working on at kind of the board's request, and that is the subject of performance evaluation or the performance evaluation process. And I'd like to distribute these to the commissioners, and we have some extras. Craig, who do you want to get these extras?
Whoever wants it.
Well, they're here. But what we've been looking at, examining for the past several months, all of the department heads have some form of evaluation tool for the employees in their departments. There are three positions in the county that report directly to the Board of Commissioners. One is the county manager, one is the county attorney, and one is the tax administrator. And we have not had any formal tool of performance evaluation or really even a job description to talk to these three positions, whoever they are in at the time. And so what Craig did, along with Tori and Clyde and others, is looked around at other counties and drew some, I guess, evaluation tools. And Craig, correct me when I go off here the wrong way, but basically looking at other counties for some input on how we could do this. These positions basically are all management-oriented positions. They deal with decision-making. They deal with how they deal with their constituents, both within the county and obviously our citizens. And what we've come up with, what Craig and Clyde and Gerald have come up with, and all have reviewed this, I believe,
yes, sir,
is kind of a standardized form that would allow us to, number one, understand the job description of each of these three. You can see it's incorporated in one form, but also then as a way for the board or a board to provide evaluation for the particular position. And where we are in the year, this form does not at all imply that there's going to be, following a performance evaluation, a salary increase. That's really not what it's about. It really is a feedback tool to be used so that the board can sit down with the individuals in these positions periodically and comment on, okay, here's what we're doing, what can we do better, what are our expectations of the position. And if you look, I think it's the last page, there is a under the measurable goals section on the very last page, there also includes an opportunity for the board more or less to indirectly evaluate how the board as a whole has contributed to the certain position's success, what we as a board can do to support the position going forward. So again, we talk about this, but we don't really have it in a framework that is presented here. So I just like to throw it out to everybody. We can be used in a couple of ways fairly soon. I think we can use it to review specific accountabilities, descriptions of a person that would come new into one of these three positions. It also would allow us to make comments in an evaluation sense about the individuals that are in the position now. Again, not a salary review, it is a performance review. So that's what my thinking is as we progress. Craig, do you want to comment, or Clyde? Gerald's not here tonight, is he? But you want to talk about the input you received from the others? What
we did is, as the board's aware, we took three different valuations, I think, that you got about a month ago, and tried to look at what was the best of each one and how we felt like it would fairly be able to evaluate and to give you a tool that would help evaluate us. And also, we need to know what we do right and what we do wrong and how we need to correct that. And so this is, again, an important valuation tool that we would like to ask that you look at Again, we are the three that report directly to the board, and we work directly for you, and we would like to get your input to make sure that we're doing the job that you and the citizens of Alamance County are expecting.
And just to show the framework, the first set of pages basically is an evaluation of what is currently being done, and the last page is more of projecting in the future what are our expectations going forward. Clyde, you're one of these three positions. Do you have any comments?
I suggested to Craig that since I work for every department in the county, maybe input from each department head would be appropriate for the county attorney's position. Just to ask them how is he perform, or how is the county attorney performing? Is it timely? Is it good legal advice? Just stay out of jail.
Well, and that's a good point. And also, I mean, for that matter, any of us could talk to any department head, you know, about perceptions of your management style. Gerald's is a little bit different in that his focus is targeted strictly to the tax department. So, what do y'all think?
I think it's a good idea.
But if you look at it and there are changes or questions or concerns, just let us know, and we can make any revision that the board so chooses.
Well, that's a good idea. Why don't we take this as a review, just take it and kind of read through it between now and the next meeting. But if there aren't any substantial changes or additional changes, what I would suggest is that we maybe make a copy of this for each of the three positions and do go through the process where we would sit down with each person in the position, say the first part of January, one of those two meetings, or in a special meeting to have a performance evaluation. Again, not tied to a salary increase or a bonus, but basically,
do you understand that, Chris?
Yeah, that is about as quick as crystal. Yes, sir.
But it's hard for the board to hold an individual accountable if the individual doesn't know what the expectations are. That's what it comes down to.
Yes, sir.
So is everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
That worked. And Eddie, obviously, we're going to get your input. As well. Linda, you all right with that?
Sure. I did this in Orange County.
Okay.
That's how they do it.
You
a little harder.
You didn't do it in Hall River?
That's how we did it where I worked.
That's how I did it in Orange County.
Yeah. Something like this?
Yep. Similar. Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, hold this, keep it at the top of your stack, and we'll see if there are any reactions or changes for the next meeting, and if not, we'll go ahead and put it into place after that. Greg, that'll work for you?
Yes, sir.
All right, and you'll convey that to Gerald as well?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your work on that. This time, speaking of county manager, we have you on the agenda next.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In front of you is a declaration of the election results from our bond referendum for ACC. And in following our bond schedule, one thing that we have to do is after canvassing, the board has to accept the report, accept the results, and then we have to advertise this in the paper ASAP. So the canvassing results are in front of you, and with your approval, there needs to be a vote on the report from the Board of Elections.
Craig, what will this do by putting it in, by going through this process and putting in the paper? What does that mean? What does it really mean?
Ratifies the results. The board has accepted. The board has gone through canvassing. Basically, we accept the results as presented to us. It doesn't mean we're going out and buying bonds tomorrow.
So we're basically
rubber stamping the results.
Don't use that term.
I'm sorry.
The statute requires it.
It is statutory. We're reinforcing
the work of Kathy Holland.
Yes, and the statute's required for bond.
159-61 requires this board to take the report from the Board of Elections and publish it in the newspaper, whether it passes or whether it doesn't pass.
Okay. Thank you. That's helpful. Is there a motion to ratify the vote that was submitted to this board by the Alamance County Board of Elections?
So moved.
Thank you, Tim. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Any discussion or questions for Craig or Clyde on this particular matter? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Craig.
Thank you. And I do want to welcome the Boy Scouts that are here tonight. We did a citizenship in the community merit badge class last Thursday night, and part of the requirements was they had to come and sit through a local meeting. So I do appreciate the boys, and they were very attentive and very, very good class, and also appreciated them doing the flag ceremony to begin.
That's great.
So,
your local government at work.
Well, and I'll echo those comments. And the same for the Leadership Alamance Group. That's a year-long program sponsored by the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce. We have how many of you here? Because somebody came in late, right? Five? Did the same thing. Sat through a session, several sessions, and one of their requirements, and they have a report card they have to turn in and justify it, or would it prove whatever y'all are doing.
Prove they were here.
and they stayed. They stayed for the whole thing. But you all, and the scouts as well, you had an excellent opportunity, I think hearing the report from Sheriff Johnson on law enforcement, hearing a little bit about the budget, how it works, hearing about personnel. Not overly exciting stuff, but very important stuff to the operations of running the county. So I certainly agree.
All right. And also wanted to mention remind you of the local elected officials breakfast on December 5th at ACC at 7:30. That's all I have right now.
Speaking of which, can you just, you or Clyde, about the ACC bond and the sales tax vote and so forth, where do we go from here?
We have 7 years to issue the bonds if the board so chooses. And at this point, is when you tell us that you're ready to issue bonds and we have a funding source to pay for the debt service, however you want to fund that. But you don't have to do anything. Is that?
That's correct.
Thank you.
We have 7 years to make that decision.
Without going back.
Without going back to the voters. Right. The vote stands for a 7-year period.
Well, I do want to give credit to Dr. Nadelman at Alamance Community College. He has been very gracious in this process and during the outcome. I want to tell just a quick story. He spoke to the chamber retreat folks and was talking about the college and the statistics, much like Sheriff Johnson was talking about his department. He was talking about the growth in the students, and his last slide said, bond passed, now what? And he said he had the answer in his satchel. He had a big satchel, and they pulled up the satchel, and the first thing he brought out was a church offering plate. And he said, if that doesn't work, and then you started hearing bells ringing, he brought out the Salvation Army with the bells and had a bucket to hold out. So we do have challenges in front of us. We do not have an identified funding source to do what the voters have asked to be done with respect to the ACC building. So that's something that we're going to be looking at closely as we move forward. So it's an interesting time for sure. That's all you have, Craig?
Yes, sir.
Commissioner, comments or announcements? Do we have anything else? I'm sorry, we don't do that yet, do we? We don't do that yet. We're going to do this first. And again, for the scouts and other guests, what we typically do at the close of the meeting is we'll have commissioner comments and closing comments. We actually do have several matters that we're going to go into closed session for. Again, it's not an exciting time, and unless y'all really just want to hang around, there's really no need for you. You still get full credit on your papers. So at this time, and again, I thank y'all for being here. And you're welcome to hang around, but that's up to you. The motion, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A4 to discuss matters relating to the location or expansion of industries or other businesses in Alamance County, including agreement on a tentative list of economic development incentives that may be offered in negotiations. And I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 143-318.11A6 to consider the qualifications and conditions of initial employment of an individual. I will make that motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Any discussion about the motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? We will go into closed session. Thank you all again for being here.